When you think about classic Mercedes, a few words come to mind. That is my new 1982 Mercedes-Benz 300D. And let me tell you what, guys, it's not what you think. Yes, it's very pretty, and yes, the interior is very comfortable, but there is so much more to this car. That just happens to be one of my all-time dream cars, and I feel so lucky and fortunate to have been able to acquire this example. Let me show you why this car is so special. If you follow the channel, then you know that I recently purchased a 1976 Mercedes 450 SL convertible. I bought it for $3,500, and the reason I bought it is because I really wanted one of these, and there just weren't any available on Craigslist. I got impatient and I bought that red one. Now, it's a nice car, it looks great, it runs okay, but I made the mistake of buying one that just needs a little bit too much work, and it's gonna cost a whole lot more than it's worth to get it to the point where I want it to be. So, like a week later, this guy popped up and I bought him, $6,800. And this truly is one of my all-time dream cars. I have been lusting over this car for probably 5-6 years now. I just haven't found the right one, just haven't had enough money. I finally was able to put two and two together and purchase this guy. And it is a lovely example. Now let me show you why this one is so cool by popping the hood. Okay, so to open the hood on one of these old Mercedes, you pull this little plastic clip that comes out from the grill and lift the whole hood open. That's one big chunk of metal. Now this engine doesn't look like much. It's a 5-cylinder inline diesel. It develops about 120 horsepower and 170 pound-feet of torque. But I'll show you the special part that got me so excited about this guy. Right down there. That's right. This is a factory turbo diesel equipped car. It's not particularly rare, but it does mean that this car is immensely more drivable up here at elevation than its naturally aspirated counterpart. So 170 horsepower, 120 pound-feet of torque will get this car down the road just fine. But the reason this engine is so special and the reason I've wanted one of these cars for so long is that these engines are pretty much bulletproof. They are just about indestructible. A little bit of diesel, a little bit of air, and a little bit of compression is all you need to get these things to run. Heck, you don't even need diesel. Something vaguely flammable and vaguely oily will get this engine to run. And they will go for upwards of 200,000 to 300,000 miles if properly maintained. And you often see these things on Craigslist with 300, even 400,000 miles. Right, so I thought first of all I'd show you guys really quickly how this thing starts and drives because it's a little bit unusual. Now I put the key into the slot, that's pretty standard, and undo the steering lock. There we go. Now I turn it to on and I have to wait till this glow plug light goes off. Being a diesel, it's got glow plugs, they need to heat up. This engine is a little bit hot right now, so I don't need to worry about that too much. And there it goes. Now it sounds like an absolute Mack truck from like 1964, and that is really cool. It's pretty loud at idle, but it really quiets up once you go down the road. So I just shift this into drive, which is super easy and delicate. 4-speed automatic transmission, and we'll get on our way here. Okay, so we're pulled over here on the side of the road. The engine is idling nicely at about 600 RPM. I have to check my mirrors to make sure there's not a car within the next zip code, and you'll soon see what I'm talking about, because this engine makes no power between 700 RPM, it's idle, and about 2200 RPM. And now, granted, this engine probably needs a tune-up and we are a mile above sea level, but once that turbo hits at about 2200 RPM, it really takes off. So I'm gonna merge, and now floored. Nothing, nothing, there it goes. What a cool sound. That has got to be one of the coolest sounds in any automobile. It is such a unique noise. The turbo hits and it just spools beautifully. I'll show you one more time here. Floored, nothing, nothing, floored, nothing, still floored. Still floored. Oh, something's happening. And there we go. And a little stream of black smoke for good measure out the back at full throttle. Okay, so let's talk about why I've been lusting over this car for so long. Yes, the engine is practically bulletproof, but so is the rest of this car. It's not rare by any means. They built over 2.7 million of these old Mercedes. It's not called an E-Class, it's not called a C-Class back then. They just called it a Mercedes 300D, but it really is the predecessor to the modern day E-Class. And if you look at it, well, the design, if you're not a Mercedes purist, is nothing to write home about. There is one box in the front where the engine lives, one box in the middle where you sit, and then one box in the back where the trunk goes. It's a very simple design, but the attention to detail and the attention to overall quality is impeccable. And that is the real reason I love this car. It is a piece of art in terms of build quality. This one is 47 years old, and you will not find one panel that fits worse than another panel. Pretty much every single door seam, every single panel gap is perfect. These cars were built to such a high degree of perfection. And I'll give you an example. I know this is a bit of a cliche, but listen to the noise it makes when you shut the door. Wow. Just listen one more time. Incredible. And you'll see the door seam nearly flawless all the way down. 47 years old this car is. This one has 148,000 miles, so it's by no means a low mileage example. $6,800 is probably too much for this car, but I just got so excited when I saw it on Craigslist, I couldn't wait. Now there are a ton of fine details that make this car so special. First off, let's look at the front. Take a look at how they did these headlights. Of course, in the US, it had to comply to standards of the day, which means sealed beam units, but they're so well integrated into the front of this car. So many of these vehicles back in the day that were Americanized looked terrible with American headlights and great with the European versions. This car is not one of those. It looks really good in both American or European spec. Now, other things you notice on the exterior, well, there's not really a whole lot to talk about, if I'm being honest. Tiny wheels for today's standards, 14-inch wheels, but it means this car rides like a dream and has a super, super, super tiny turning radius for the size. Now, speaking of size, we often like to talk about how much bigger cars have gotten. And yes, that's true, but this is still a very large car. Not in terms of width, not in terms of height, but it is really long. Park it next to even a modern midsize sedan, and this car doesn't look exactly small. And this one has held up miraculously. Original paint and pretty much no rust. The only speck of rust is back here underneath the turbo diesel badge where water is collected, probably in that little trim piece. And then on the front, this is an easy fix. The license plate bracket has got some surface rust on it, so I'll probably pull that off and repaint it. But other than that, the car is rust-free. It's in really nice condition. Now, there are a couple of other things that need attention, and I'll show you those on the interior. The interior in these are simple, they're not overwrought, but they are once again beautiful in their simplicity. Let's take a seat. Oh, yes. You're greeted by this large in-your-face steering wheel with the Mercedes three-pointed star in the middle. Let me close up this door. Ready? Ready? Listen, listen, listen. Oh, oh. So the steering wheel has got this really nice texture. It's really satisfying to hold on to. Same thing with the gear shift. And there's a lot of wood across the interior. It's not veneer. This is actually real wood. Down here, it's starting to crack a little bit. I think this is a veneer. Comment below if you know for sure. I'm still getting to know this car. Ashtray, of course, it was the 80s. I have the original radio in the box. This is an aftermarket unit. Automatic temperature controls here. Antenna lights. And that's pretty much it. I think I just went over all the features in about 3 minutes. Now, you do have power windows down here with your fader control here and your hazard button. Now, the other sound you hear is my butt squeaking on these seats. Okay, let's talk about these seats really quick. This color is called Palomino, and you'd expect it to be leather being a Mercedes, but it's not leather. It's actually made out of a material called MBTEX.
Yikes, so you're probably thinking at this point, wow, you bought yourself a classic Mercedes that doesn't even have leather seats. Yes, I did, and here's what you have to understand about that MBTEX material. Like everything else in the Mercedes W123, it is over-engineered to the nth degree. You'll see these old cars with 300,000 miles. None of the windows will go down, the radios won't work, it won't have air conditioning, the climate control system will be busted overall, but there are two things that'll still work. The engine will keep rattling along, and those MBTEX seats will look like new. You see, the MBTEX material is impervious to rips, tears, and nuclear wars. I don't understand how this material can be so durable, but you'll see these cars in horrific shape with rust holes the size of Kansas in the side, and the seats will look pretty much brand new. These cars, upon startup and at idle and accelerating, sound like old Peterbilt trucks, which is awesome. It's a really cool sound, but it also means that just like a Peterbilt truck, there are a lot of vacuum lines in an old Mercedes, and here's what I'm talking about. Pretty much everything in here is controlled by a vacuum pump that is operated off the engine. The door locks, for example, go up and down using vacuum. The cruise control is vacuum operated, and the climate control is vacuum operated. So this weird and wacky little wheel that adjusts the temperature and where things go, that's all vacuum operated, which is great when it works, but when you have a vacuum leak, things start going haywire. So the door locks in this car are a little bit slow. The climate control works luckily, but it is also a little bit slow to respond. I'm fine with all that. The bigger issue is the transmission. Now the transmission shift points and even the harshness are controlled by vacuum. And this one shifts too hard between first and second gear, and it kind of clunks back and forth between other gears. Now, in any other car, you'd probably think your transmission is shot, but from the research I've done and several helpful YouTubers, you guys know who you are out there, who really specialize in these cars, I'm pretty sure it's a vacuum issue. There are also a couple other quirks you have to get used to in an old Mercedes. These were expensive cars. Mercedes are expensive today, and they were expensive back then, especially a 300D turbo diesel. Now, compared to other cars of equivalent cost back in the day, this isn't all that well equipped. For example, yes, it has cruise control, yes, it has automatic climate, which is cool, but you still have manually adjusting mirrors. You still have manually adjusting seats for both the slide and the recline. You don't have a tilt or telescoping steering wheel. So, you know, you didn't get that many options on this car that you wouldn't get in an equivalent Lincoln or Cadillac or even Ford or Mercury. And yet none of that matters to me whatsoever, because what this 80s Mercedes had that none of those 1980s Lincolns or Cadillacs had was quality. You still see these cars running around the streets of Morocco with hundreds of thousands of miles, spewing out black smoke with rust holes in every panel and huge dents and missing interior bits, and they just go and they go and they go. I'm coming across as a total fanboy, and that's because I am a total fanboy. But you show me someone who thinks their modern car is as durable as a 1980s Mercedes, and I'll show you a liar, because I just don't think it's true. These cars were engineered so well. Yes, they're expensive to fix, and yes, you have to maintain them. But if you do that, they will just keep going, and we'll see how far this one goes, because I plan on keeping this baby for a long time. Sorry, I'm just addicted to the door noise it makes when you close it. But anyways, guys, leave me a comment below what you think of my old Benz. You can't tell, but I'm very proud of her. Very, very proud of her. I hope to fix the little things to get this into perfect condition. Maybe repaint these wheels because they're looking a little bit sad, fix that tiny bit of rust on the trunk, get the vacuum system back up to order, and then take this thing on some amazing adventures, because this is one amazing car. For the 8 of you that decided to click on this video and watch it, thank you, I appreciate it. Please leave a comment below, please hit that like button, and we'll see you guys next time. Now there are about 100 million cool things I really want to show you guys about this old Mercedes, but as an introduction video, I don't want to do that right now. We'll get into that in future episodes. But one cool thing, just as a teaser, are these tail lights.
Now they're ribbed, but the reason they do that is because in theory, you're supposed to be able to see them even when they're dirty.